Okay, we're going to get started on this chat and getting to know you session with some artists who are here from Spain to promote their new anthology, Spanish Fever, which just came out from Fantagraphics. My name is Matt Madden, and I'll be moderating. And to kind of set the scene, to set the Spanish comic scene a little bit, I'll start with a quick anecdote. The first time I went to Spain with Jessica Abel, my wife, was in 1999, right after the Angoulême Comics Festival, so in a chilly February. And I'd gotten to know, and this is a whole other anecdote, because it was a public swimming pool in Texas, a well-known Spanish editor and writer named Hernán Migoya, who at that time was editor for La Cúpula for Kiss Comics, which was a pornographic monthly comics series. He invited us to come down and visit him in Barcelona after the Angoulême Festival, and we spent a wonderful but very cold several days with him and a bunch of other friends, including an artist named Santiago Siqueiros, who's not in the anthology, I think, but and several other people I've forgotten. And one of our goals was to, like, all right, let's figure out what's going on in the Spanish comic scene. We're here, we're with cartoonists, we're with an editor from the major, you know, La Cúpula, which is kind of the Fantagraphics of Spain. And they basically, like, with, you know, long faces, kind of dragged us from one comic book store to another, Continuará, which is a very famous store in comics. And they'd be like, well, there used to be a publisher that was doing, you know, this, and there used to be Nosotros Somos Los Muertos, which was an anthology that the cartoonist Max, that many of you may know of, was publishing for a while, but they were saying, well, Max got so burnt out, you know, sub-publishing it and complete indifference from the buying public and from the media, that everyone now is just kind of like totally burnt out, and everyone was just kind of, the cartoonists, the editors, the publishers, it was just like this, it was like the February weather, it was just like this cold, dreary period. And we had a great time. We ended up catching our train back to the airport, and all of them took us out all night, and we went to a terrible party, which consisted in five people sitting against a wall, and one guy playing air guitar to, For Those About to Rock, We Salute You. And finally ended up having churros in front of the Barcelona train station at 5 a.m, and we all sat around falling asleep until the train station opened and we got our train out of there. A wonderful experience. We had good friends who we're still friends with, but we came away completely depressed about the comic scene. Like, this is terrible. It's died before it's even started. But in the years to follow, we got invited back to other festivals, to Semana Negra in the north of Spain, and to the Viñetas Desio Atlántico Festival in La Coruña. And slowly but surely, these new publishers started to show up, Astiberri, Sin Sentido, and young artists and young writers and critics started to appear on the scene. And suddenly we had this, well, now it seems sudden, it was actually a very slow growth, this extremely vibrant scene in Spain, which is pretty unknown outside the peninsula. So it's great that we finally have this anthology out here. And it's been edited and put together by the man sitting to my left, who I'm going to hand the mic to. First, I will just announce, I'll introduce everyone down the row here. So this is Santiago García. He writes about comics, and he writes comics, and he's the editor of this collection. To my right is Javier Olivares, who is an illustrator and cartoonist, has done several books in collaboration with Santiago, among other people. David Rubín, who some of you might know, he's done work with Paul Pope on the Aurora West series from the Battling Boy world, as well as his own excellent work. Also has collaborated with Santiago. It's going to come back to this guy a lot today. José Domingo, who has done several books with No Brow Publishing, and Ana Galvañ, who you're allowed to just say Galvañ. You'll notice there's a little tilde on the N at the end of her name, and most people, including Spaniards, I think, look at it and say, huh? How do you pronounce that? So it's okay to just call her Ana Galvañ. And she's been doing mini comics and independent stuff as well as illustration work. And we're going to see all of their work in a few minutes. So, Santiago, I'll let you set the scene a little bit further about the positive side of the Spanish comic scene.
The positive is we are still here. We are still standing. So I'm going to move to the computer so I can begin with a slide presentation and it would be better. Well, I think I should just say a few words about what's the Spanish Fever and a little bit of context so you all understand where we're coming from with this thing. A Spanish Fever is a book that has its roots in Panorama, which is mostly the same book that we published in Spain in 2013. And the idea was to put together a sample of what a lot of different people was doing in Spain during the last 5 to 10 years, which was pretty different from the bleak scenario that Matt just rightly described. I mean, we have a long and beautiful and strong tradition of commercial comics, just like in any other Western country. This was especially for during the 40s, 50s, until into the 80s, when everything crumbled down. So it mostly disappeared, and then at the start of the 2000, 2001 or so, I honestly thought that Spanish comics was done, and we will have never again any kind of national comic. But suddenly something changed, and we'll see what, and that's the context that Panorama and Spanish Fever now in English is trying to present. So, Panorama in Spain in 2013 became Spanish Fever in the US in just in last month. It's mostly the same with different cover, but the content is there. What changed is that when we thought that we will never again have Spanish comics, if the idea was around 2000 that if you were a talented person in Spain that who wanted to work in comics, you will have to do it like work for hire for the French or the American industry mostly, but you will never be able to build a career doing your own comics in Spain. But suddenly, the graphic novel appeared. The graphic novel, which is a term that I know is very controversial and has been interpreted and taken for a lot of different things in many places, but in Spain, it has acquired some kind of relevance and significance very different from other places. It's something that we are starting not to debate about. And during the first half of the 2000s years, we started to have a lot of imported graphic novels that started to change our way of thinking. They started to get to our reading audience, which was not the typical comics reader. It was mostly like people interested in literature, in novels, in fiction, or even in non-fiction. But we still needed to prove that that kind of comic, which till that moment was like Persepolis by Marjan Satrapi, or even Blankets by Craig Thompson, or those kind, or maybe Frederick Peters and other international creators, could work with Spanish authors. And then it's gone when Arrugas, Wrinkles by Paco Roca appeared. This was in 2007. And this changed everything. It was like a turning point. After this, everyone, every publisher in Spain knew that if they wanted to do some kind of comic that could still get to the to a bigger audience, it would be probably a graphic novel. Arrugas has been published in the US just this year by Fantagraphics. I think it's the last country in which it has been published, because it has been translated into Japan even and all over the world. To this day in Spain, it has sold like more than 75,000 copies. It has been made into a feature movie. It's a huge bestseller. So it's not the only one, obviously. I mean, we have Max. Max is a well-known author in many places, including the US. These books have been published also by Fantagraphics. He was like kind of an inspiration to all of us because he's a little bit older. He started out in the 80s, but he kept going with doing like his own very personal comics that inspire us. And
Santiago, I might just interject one historical note there, that Max is from kind of a very particular generation in Spain too,
yeah.
which is the post-Franco era, which was one other previous, kind of analogous to the American underground comics, where
yeah.
after Franco the dictator died, and at the era where Almodovar became, you know, started making his films, and that kind of very exuberant aesthetic of freedom and liberty, Max and a bunch of other cartoonists, Miguel Gallardo and other people who are still active, had a series of magazines, most famously El Víbora, Totem Comics, and a couple
yeah,
of other titles.
The translation, but El Víbora especially, yeah. and Cairo were like the new wave of adult Spanish cartoonists
right.
from the 80s.
But this
90s.
Is like, yeah, early through the 80s, and by the late 90s, it had sort of petered out, and
that's,
it seemed like, oh, well, that was,
that's right.
we
that's
missed
exactly
our chance,
right.
kind of.
And Max was the only one who, you know, kept going on when everyone else, I mean, there was a lot of
the Max, Max abides.
Yeah, he's a survivor. So, well, John Cornellà is well known over the world, also published in the US. He's working mostly on online, but, and Marty is from the same generation than Max. He's been also publishing in the US. I mean, he's from the 80s, 90s. This is absolutely awesome. I mean, he's one of my favorites ever. He's kind of a Spanish Chester Gould or something like that, but with a bit of underground in him. And well, after Winkles, we started to have a kind of different books, a kind of different graphic novels that we have before, which is not, difference are in the way that they are sold and packaged. I mean, they are sold mostly in general bookstores. They are sold in specialty bookstores as well. But the distinctive thing was that they will be found alongside the latest, like, literary novels or any other thing. They will be reviewed in cultural supplements. They will be reviewed. We started to have a government sponsor, national prize, which will be a big deal. So suddenly, the society and the institutions were starting to treat comics like something that was cool and relevant in cultural terms. So we started to have books that, like The Arte de Volar, The Art of Flying, which were about memory, history, family, and personal things. This is about the history of the father of the writer who fought for the side that lost the Civil War, and then the decades that followed that and what he did. Dubliner by Alfonso Zapico is biographical, is the biography of James Joyce. This is a classic history book by Paul Preston about the Spanish Civil War that has been made into a graphic novel just this year, and it is selling like crazy. I mean, I think it had like 4 editions in 1 month or something like that. So, I mean, people are buying this book. I mean, it's not like we're alternative, like we will be thought of maybe in the US, but it's the same kind of books that you might find here, but we are in some way now the mainstream in Spain because we're getting to the society at large. And these are just a few more examples which approach topics on like sickness, politics, and current themes. This is a little bit of comics journalism about homeless in Barcelona. And then there are other trends. Another different trend is starting to appear, especially during the last few years. I will call it almost post-graphic novel, which is a kind of comics much more artistic, like more avant-garde, much formalist. This is an adaptation without words of a classic book by Nietzsche. So, and things that don't even look like regular comics. There are a lot of this. This is kind of thing, for example, that Anna usually does. And the third, and I'm going to close with this trend that we will have starting to try different things, are it's like online comics. This is a satirical monthly that you can download, paying 150 euros or a little bit more. This is by a Spanish artist, Spanish colorist, and an American writer, and you can download it by nothing or whatever you like to pay. And this is from a Spanish guy who is working with the same that the previous one. So suddenly we are in a better place than we were a few years ago. We're very hopeful. We're having a lot of creative freedom, and at the same time we're getting some commercial hits. And Spanish theater is like the gateway to start to know all that kind of books. And I think there are more coming to the U.S. in the next months. So now we're going to let that each one of these artists explain a little bit about the particularities of their work. Thank you.
Okay. So Anna, you're going to start and read a carefully prepared speech.
Hello. ¿Se oye bien? Thanks for coming. I want to say thanks to Matt for helping us. I want to say thanks to Santiago García for count on me for the anthology, and to Warren, I think he's not here, but he invited us to SPX, so yeah, it's an honor. Thank you for coming, you people. So I'm not so comfortable speaking English because it's hard to me to make an elaborate thought, so I'm going to speak slowly. Thank you. I'm from Murcia. It's a beautiful town in the south of Spain. It's our California there. It's very nice. This is my story for the anthology. Excuse me. This I think 13 pages mini comic inside the anthology. It's about two teenage ponies who meet after school, and they go to a secret cave to talk about their teenage issues, like boyfriends and classmates and their parents. And they also smoke some joints and take some drugs. So everything, step by step, turns more lethargic, more surreal and dark. Yes, no, please. La anterior, por favor. Yes. I was inspired in this story by a joy I had when I was a child. Maybe you know it, it's My Little Pony. It was a beautiful toy, too much beautiful, yes, with the long, bright, colorful hair that you have to brush with a little comb. And those bright and big eyes. So it was a little sinister, no? Like it had a devil inside or something. So I think all my generation is a bit obsessed with that toy. And for this story, I wanted to make a comparison between our vision of reality that is sometimes unreal. It's like a magic, it's like magical, and all makes sense and all fits on it. But when you have a very bad experience, like an accident, or someone close to you died, you can see other things, no? Life division turns sharp and vivid and cruel and real. So that was I wanted to express on this. Thank you. Again, this is again, a short story made for anthology, made for a small publisher from the north of Spain called Fosfatina, and they support emerging authors and experimental things. So I wanted to make this more experimental story. It's about the different actions in the reality. I wanted to show you all the infinite action that we never can see. And I wanted to know.
¿Puedes poner la anterior?
Esa. I wanted to show all of them at the same time. It's very complicated for me to express that. So also I wanted to experiment with the panels on the page and make it not so classical. Yes, different structure, different lines, and sometimes a rather small.
¿Puedes poner la siguiente?
Sorry.
La anterior.
Esta. That small panels that they are assume about the action, no? Like a spotlight into the story. Thank you. The next, please. Yes. Sorry.
Por la anterior, por favor.
Perdón. Yes, you can see all the action at the same times. Yes, but they are a little different. This is an autobiographical story. This happened to me last year. I lost my cell phone, so I had to use that old phone. Yes, and it's a very dangerous phone, that old phone, everybody knows. So later than this, I went to a hospital, so I'm recovered now. So I wanted to make it so realistic, you know, like this. So it was scary. Thank you. this is one of my latest works with Fosfatina again, the small publishers. It's a short story with 16 pages. It's called Luz Verdadera, in English maybe The One True Light. It's about a bunch of women who lives in the forest in a kind of cult. They are very, very naive people, but strange, and they live some nice experience, but sometimes are disturbing. And watching all my comics now, I realize that I want to talk about the relation between friends.
¿Puedes poner otra imagen en la que están hablando los dos personajes, por favor? Anterior, por favor.
Yes, like this. Yes, like in the ponies story, it's the same. I'm interested on the relation between female friends, because they are complex and they are rich. And that's all. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Anna. Okay, moving down the line, as it happens, José Domingo is going to show some of his work now.
Okay, hello, thanks to you all for being here today. And this is my story for one of the pages for my story for Spanish Fever. It's called Number Two Has Been Murdered, and it's, I usually do humor, and absurd humor is my favorite thing to do. Like try to, in some way, do a reflection on sometimes how serious things are and how silly in the, you know, they truly are. And in this case, this story tells, it's like a joke. We have these serious people, kind of black suit CIA guys in a meeting room, and they have to communicate a really bad news that number two of the organization was killed or murdered. They don't know who killed number two, so they the boss is going to communicate who was who killed the number two using a very special protocol to communicate bad news. which is charades. So it's like doing all the gestures, and the other guy has to have to guess the words for who killed the guy, and it escalates in a way. It turns into a kind of movie game, you know, when you have to guess the movie the other person is saying, each of the words, and it ends up being like a completely silly situation and stupid, because they got so much into the game that they end up competing between them, see who won, instead of just missing the importance of the message. So for this comic, I usually work in color. So as you can see, this one is black and white, quite a harsh style. It's like very geometrical, very dry. And this is because this story can only be told in a comic. This style and the way of storytelling, the kind of panels I'm using, the composition of the panels, it's setting up the tone of something like serious and harsh, setting up the tone for the joke. It's like being a counterpart for the core of the story, which is like being silly. So it's told in a way that you can't detach the text from the image, because both are building the story at the same time. And that's the magic of comics, and that's why comics are great. And these are some of my other works. This is Adventures of a Japanese Businessman. This book was published here in the US by Noblau, after being published in Spain and France back in 2011. And this is my first solo book, and my best known book. It was even nominated for the Eisner Awards a couple of years ago. And it's, again, I'm using humor here, and especially absurd humor. This is the story of a Japanese businessman that comes out of work to head back home on a regular day, and the most strange things start to happen to him. And it's a bit of an experimental comic as well, in the way that it's told with this fixed grid of panels, four panels per page. It's always the same point of view. The character is always in the more or less in the middle of the panel, and it was created with no previous script. I didn't write this comic before starting to draw it, because I wanted to move the character forward in the story and follow him. So as he goes through the background, through the environment, I draw this panel, and then I imagine the movement he's following, and I draw the next panel, and the comic is building itself as the character advances and moves forward. Apart from these formal rules I set to myself, sometimes I use the panel composition or the page composition to do some special things or to tell in special moments to tell some things. This is at the end, and for me, drawing comics is a way of thinking. A kind of unconscious thinking. In this case, here the Japanese businessman who at this point of the story is in the stomach of an alien. It's something pretty common to happen. And then he finds that a whole bunch of characters that are like him. And he starts to melt with all these other little Japanese businessmen that are like him. And finally, like a giant character appears made of out of all of them. It's like being like achieving like whole consciousness or something like that. The thoughts that I really didn't have like in my formulated in my mind, but they came through the they came out by through the way of doing the comic. This is a story I did for Island. This is which is a magazine published by Image Comics. Basically, here you can see that I'm a bit into formal experimentation, a bit like doing a bit of extreme or playing a lot with forms and color. In this one, I'm telling the story of a guy who arrives to an island, like a virgin island, idyllic, and so, and he get it's lost in that island, but it starts to turn it into a more industrial thing, like taming the island, the nature and the inhabitants, the poor birds that live in the island, but ends up being like a kind of a dictator dressed with a metallic suit or something and just doing what he wants with the rest of the inhabitants of the island. You can go next if you want. This was for Nobro magazine. I think it was issue number 8, called with the theme of hysteria. This is again a bit of an experimental kind of story with no words, just this blah, trying to tell through the drawings and through the comic the mood of what's happening, like using this composition with a lot of little panels. What I wanted to express is the how tired is this guy, the protagonist of the story, of like being assaulted all the time by all the different things you do in life, when you are tired or when you are a bit like fed up with everything and looks like everything is talking to you or pushing you in a way. And this is what happens to this guy. After this page, the guy just breaks down and starts, you know, goes to work and handles a gift to their boss and starts like breaking stuff and and running away. And now lately I'm stepping into the field of comics for kids or books for kids. This one is from Pablo and Jane and the Hotel Contraption. This is a book published by Flying Eye Books last year, and it's a mix of a comic and a Where's Waldo hide and seek kind of picture book, because this is the part of the comic when I tell the story of the kids that travel to the monster dimension and they arrive to a world filled with monsters where the kids have to find the different things in the drawings. And can go next, Santiago. And this is the new comic I'm working on right now, again for kids, because I enjoyed so much working in the other one. Now I wanted to step into this field, because even comics, it's a classical genre or field for comics for kids. It's like a classical field for comics. Right now, it's not that easy to find comics for kids. Comics have turned into a more mature audience, and now I wanted to try my hand at this and to create comics for kids, because I think it's really great. And one thing I can't really stand very much is that the many things that are addressed to kids right now feels like they come out of nowhere. There's like no one is behind that doing the job. There's no creators. They just consume the content like if it comes out of the blue. So I wanted to create like something from an author's perspective for kids. Even though this sounds really serious, this is going to be fun. It's about a super group of vampires, so cannot be boring. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Thank you.
Good. Thanks.
Hi, my name is David. Okay. My pal said me that I try to be quick, and it's better for that way that the kindly Matt translate me and talk to you in Spanish, and then I go so quickly than in English. So sorry, and my apologies.
Okay, we'll try. So.
Okay.
Anda.
Esta primera página que podéis ver pertenece a, va incluida en la antología Spanish Fever, y lo que he contado un poco con esta historia usando estos dos iconos tan conocidos del cómic norteamericano, Batman y Superman, es...
Ahí traduzco un poco. So this, what we're seeing here is his story from Spanish Fever,
called Demolition, and in it he's playing around with the icons of Batman and Superman.
Es por un lado una especie de patada en el culo al mainstream de superhéroes americano actual.
It's meant to be kind of a kick in the ass to the American mainstream comic scene.
But with love.
But with love, yeah.
Yeah.
A loving kick in the ass.
I love it, I love it. Yeah, a mí me gustan mucho los tebeos de superhéroes. Aprendí a leer con ellos y a crecer y a dibujar, y soy autor de cómics a día de hoy gracias a que he leído cómics de superhéroes americanos.
American superhero comics were his initial inspiration, which I think you can see from the drawing style even. That's your DNA as American superhero comics.
Y justamente porque los amo tanto, me duele ver que cada vez algo que debería ser todo emoción, fantasía e imaginación se está convirtiendo en algo cada vez más aburrido. Algo que debería ser todo, pues, emoción, fantasía.
¿Pero con esta página o con tu trabajo en general?
No, con esta página. Hablo de los cómics de superhéroes americanos, que para mí deberían ser muy, pues eso, mucho más divertidos y tal. No lo son, y...
So he's looking for the emotion, the excitement of superhero comics that he's not finding these days. It's kind of like a sort of a wake-up call or something.
Y por eso he decidido hacer este cómic, pues contando lo que pienso al respecto de eso, de lo que se está convirtiendo a algo que para mí es maravilloso.
So this is a way of commenting on the current development of the U.S. comic, the superhero comic book scene in particular.
Esta imagen que podéis ver ahora es...
¿Qué se encuentra de Frank Miller y de Alan Moore y todo eso?
No, que va.
I'm asking if he's anti-Frank Miller or Alan Moore.
No. Es en contra de...
¿De lo que quieres más? ¿El lado emoción y aventura al lado del lado más serio y novela?
No, me encanta eso. Es más bien que me aburre el rollo de Jim Lee. I hate it.
Maybe he's sick of Jimmy.
Sorry. Yeah, it's true. Sorry, Jim. Yeah. And,
okay.
The next image. Es la portada de mi primera colaboración directamente para el mercado americano, en la que tuve la suerte de colaborar con Paul Pope, uno de mis autores preferidos.
So this is the cover from, it's just called Aurora West, which was a book done in collaboration with Paul Pope, published by First Second.
Yeah, by First Second.
As a kind of follow-up and companion piece to Paul's book, Battling Boy, from last year. And Paul wrote the script and you did all the art. Yeah. Or did you collaborate on the art a little bit, or?
Nosotros nos conocíamos de internet, de que nos gustaba el trabajo del uno al otro y tal, pero nunca habíamos directamente colaborado en un cómic. Y la verdad, para mí fue una sorpresa que me llamara para colaborar, y me ha servido y me ha abierto las puertas del mercado americano.
Mm-hmm. So he'd been corresponding with Paul, and obviously their styles are very simpatico, and you can see that it would make sense for them to collaborate together. But he was thrilled when Paul proposed that he draw this Aurora West book, and it's really opened up the doors for him in the American comic scene, and has allowed him to now work on new projects.
Hmm. Y gracias a eso, pues he conseguido que otras editoriales de Estados Unidos se interesen en mi trabajo, como por ejemplo Dark Horse, que publicó un libro que yo previamente había hecho para el mercado español, como es El Héroe, que es la imagen que podéis ver aquí.
So thanks to Roy West, he got one of his earlier Spanish books called The Hero, published by Dark Horse.
El Héroe para mí fue un antes y un después. Cuando yo hice este libro, que son dos volúmenes, que en total son 600 páginas, yo estaba en un momento en el que o conseguía vivir de los cómics o tenía que dejarlos por completo y dedicarme a otra cosa.
So The Hero is it's a two-part book, and la edición Dark Horse también es en dos volúmenes.
Sí, también.
So it's two books, and it's kind of a before and after story, also about superheroes. It has of
The Hero.
Yeah, it's also about superhero comics a little bit. Would you say?
Yeah, it's like a superhero comic, but more cool. Yeah.
So it's also, so you say it's a bit of a before and after, and it's a little bit about your struggle deciding, do I do comics or do I just let it drop? All right.
seguir haciendo cómics o si vas a dejar todo?
Sí, va a dejar todo, pero pues por suerte este cómic en España funcionó muy bien, sorprendió a mucha gente porque utilizaba, digamos, muchos recursos del cómic de superhéroes, pero mezclándolos con recursos del cómic de donde yo vengo, ¿no? Del cómic más independiente y de la novela gráfica.
Yeah, so when The Hero came out in Spain, and that's 2005, 2006.
Sí. En 2009 salió este libro.
Mm-hmm. Mid-2000s, it was a big hit, partly because he has this blend of superhero tropes with tools from independent comics.
Yeah.
It's a mixture of that.
And the next image is from Beowulf. Es un libro que yo hice con Santiago García. Ahí está.
There's a page from Beowulf written by Santiago. It's a bit of a retelling of the Beowulf legend,
like,
right? So a retelling of Beowulf done by Santiago and illustrated by David.
Y Beowulf, yo creo que tanto para mí como para Santiago, pues significó el hacer una obra que formalmente intentamos que fuera lo más moderna posible, pero al mismo, ya que la historia que cuenta es muy simple, ¿no? La historia del poema de Beowulf es bastante simple.
So the challenge was to take a very simple and, of course, very ancient story and tell it in the most modern, dynamic way possible.
Y entonces lo que intentamos fue, pues, con toda la puesta en escena, el storytelling y tal, hacer que esa historia vuelva a tener esa fuerza que nosotros creemos que tiene. Yo, de hecho, cuando leí el poema de Beowulf fue como ver una estatua etrusca, ¿no? Algo que es muy simple en las formas, pero que te impresiona muchísimo por lo monumental.
Pero háblate de dibujos etruscas.
De estatuas. De las
estatuas. Sí. So to bring the story to life and give it a kind of vitality that like you would find in an Etruscan. Yeah. Statue of a Etruscan warrior. A simple but very vital.
Lo que intentamos era conseguir con este cómic, pues, volver a encontrar esta fuerza visceral y esa furia que tienen este tipo de relatos, pero huyendo de toda la estética que suele tener de espada y brujería o del Señor de los Anillos. Mm-hmm. Tal.
So to give it a kind of a visceral power without falling too much into the trappings of like fantasy and a Lord of the Rings kind of aesthetic.
Yeah. Y esta imagen que veis aquí es una de las portadas del trabajo que estoy haciendo ahora mismo para aquí, para el mercado estadounidense. Se trata de Ether, es una serie que estoy haciendo con Matt Kind y que empieza a publicarse el mes que viene aquí.
So this is his current project, which is a collaboration with Matt Kind. Yeah. Where they're doing collaboration, Matt's doing most of the writing,
yeah,
but the art is going to be a little bit in collaboration, right? You said?
La parte artística correctada por mi cuenta, Matt solo escribe, aunque es un magnífico dibujante.
Yeah, yeah. So many of you know Matt from what's his other story is called? Los otros libros de Matt, ¿cómo se llama?
MGM and Super Spy.
Yeah, Super Spy and MGM and stuff. Anyway, so this will be a new project that will be coming out from Dark Horse next month.
Yeah.
And ahí vamos a cambiar a Javier, si no, vamos.
Muy bien.
Thank you, David. And now we're going to have Javier Olivares.
Hello. I'm very, very happy to be here. And thank you for being here also. I'm a little older on this table, so I try to be the faster. Okay. This page you can see here is a page from the story you can see in this book, in Spanish Fever, and this was published already in a magazine named Orsay. There's a magazine who made by a man, an Argentinian writer named Hernán Castiari. And it was a story very complicated to me because the original story was take place in the head of a man who thinks if killed with a car, his knife. So in 10 seconds, he imagined all the worst things and all the panic and all the things normally he would have to say, but for running to Finland and some far country to hide for the angry family who normally try to kill him. So it's a big example. It's an example I like to show how well the collaboration between a writer and a cartoonist, and what kind of things can add some disguise to the story. And it's the same thing with Santiago here, because I collaborate with Santiago in several projects. You can see here probably two or three of them. So these are samples of my work during the 80s and the 90s. Like my pal says before, in the 80s was a rise in Spain with the magazine. There was a lot of magazines, and then they fell down in the 90s. So in the 80s was a desert for us, like a comic book artist. Only was a lighthouse named Max. You say, for us was a prophet, something we had to seek and we had to follow. And for you have better idea what the mood in the period. There was this. You can see this in the name of the magazines. For example, Max made a magazine named "We Are the Dead."
Sorry, nosotros somos los muertos.
Yeah. There was another little magazine named Idiota y Diminuto. It was silly and tiny. And there was a very good publisher in that age named Sin Sentido, Nonsense. So you can see what the mood was in the 1990s, okay, where everybody was crying. Mm-hmm. And yeah. Lucky to me, my way of living is not a comic book, because I started like an illustrator in the 1990s. So today is my way of living. I try to work a lot with the magazines and the newspapers. So it's lucky, because like in our cartoons, I can do anything I want in the comics. So I choose the person to collaborate, like Santiago, for me, one of the best writers in Spain. So I like to do comic with Santiago. Feel free to be not comic. This is one of the collaboration with Santiago. It was made for a movie. It was an adaptation of a movie named Magical Girl. Was Magical Girl?
Hmm?
No,
Diamond
Flash. Okay. Yeah. The director put all kind of similar titles of his work. So this is. Very rare sample of my children books, because like Jose says before, it's very difficult to sell books for children in Spain. This is Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, that well-known novel. It's an adaptation of Santiago me did for and published in Spain. I'm very proud of this book, because instead with we hired for a publisher. We took the work like a very, very personal work. We do the best we can do. So I think it's one of my favorite books. And this is a very brief sample of a project with Santiago and I with the lab developing during the last 4 years, I think. And it's about art and artists, not only painters or sculptors, something, even also cartoonist or mad artists. This is the cover of Las Meninas. Las Meninas was my first graphic novel I did with Santiago 4 years ago. And we won the national prize in Spain last year.
Spain has had a national comics prize for 10 years now, I think.
Yes.
About six.
Max got the first one, fitting
ten.
Yeah, okay. And so it's a big deal to get this prize every year. It's like a.
Yeah, it's a very young prize, but it's very, very useful for a cartoonist that your country recognize your work and make a prize for this. No? This is a piece of Las Meninas you can see here. In Las Meninas, in comic, I like to do comics with very, very simple drawings now, because my ego, like an illustrator, put in the illustration stuff, in the illustration books. In these works, I can do anything, I can expand myself. And when I do comics, I'm very, very specific, and I try to make very legible drawings, because I think it's in a collaboration, and I only draw the things I need to tell the story. Not, I try not to add things like, you know, like a madman. And
But you can see that in Las Meninas, what's cool about the book is that these are all pages from, well, the last two at least. It's a very simple style, very recognized, very consistent from page to page, but through changing color and line, you jump back and forth in time. There's
the book tells a story about the paint. Also, the painter, of course, because he painted the big picture. But it's the story of the paint, of the picture, during the centuries, and how it influenced other artists like Picasso, that you can see here, or some of the writers or philosophers or other artists.
Yeah, there's Foucault, there's Picasso, there's a lot of people giving their anecdotes reflecting on Las Meninas and Velázquez and his importance.
Yeah.
We're going to need to stop there because we're out of time, but Las Meninas will be published by Fantagraphics to be determined, but in the future. So do keep an eye out for that. It's a really fantastic book, as is all this other stuff. Some of the stuff I haven't read, I'm going to chase it down now. We have room for books in our house, though, so it's a problem. thanks a lot for coming out. I don't think we have time for Q&A really, but these guys are around for the